So let's start with this. What's the last week been like for you?
Yeah, it's been a busy week, Chris, that's for sure. Yes, I've been trying to manage this insane level of correspondence and media interest and so forth with my day job.
What happened?
The first I heard of anything was on Saturday when a journalist reached out to our media people at Penn State wanting to interview me. And that's the first I heard that a paper of ours from 2015 had featured on Joe Rogan the night before. I obviously looked at the Joe Rogan piece, talked to the Forbes reporter, and then Mary Hell broke loose in terms of people emailing me asking questions. The views on the paper went through the roof. The Twitter sphere went crazy. It's one of the most tweeted papers of that journal at all. You know, it's been mad.
How many times has your paper been shared?
It's actually been viewed over 200,000 times since the pandemic started. So it's been crazy. And most of those views were the last week.
Wow.
Yeah, I don't think any paper of mine has ever been viewed as many times. So the Joe Rogan show on the YouTube channel I'm looking at, that shows it's been looked at 1.5 million times. And then on top of that, the scientific paper itself has been looked at least 200,000 times since the pandemic. The other thing that happened last week was I started getting emails from doctors from around the world asking me if I could put out something that they could point their patients to that would show that my paper wasn't a reason for them to avoid vaccination. I was sort of mildly thinking about that until the Joe Rogan thing happened. And now it's obviously something that needs to be taken very seriously.
Well, here's the thing. Even as an objective journalist, I was like, I saw the claim on Facebook. It was shared to me by a colleague. And I go, huh. And I look at it and I read the abstract and I read the summary and I read the material and I still go, huh. Like without explanation, without really looking into the details, some of these sentences that you've written are plausible to extrapolate what Rogan did, but it doesn't make it right. For instance, he says, you say in the paper that, you find the right sentence. You know, our data shows that anti-disease vaccines that do not prevent transmission, which is partially some of the COVID vaccines, partially, can create conditions that promote the emergence of pathogen strains that cause more severe disease in unvaccinated hosts. So again, the misinformation can lie in, if you just take that sentence out of context without the details of what vaccine you were given the chickens and how that evolved, that's some scary literature.
Absolutely. The thing is that our paper, that's what our paper shows. So with a chicken vaccine and a chicken virus, we were looking at, in what we would now call in COVID speak, variants. How do different variants get on in vaccinated and unvaccinated hosts? And so that's what we were studying and looking at. And in that particular context, what we found was that strains that are nastier cause the disease to be more severe in chickens were able to survive in vaccinated hosts and so could transmit on. And as I think we made pretty clear in that paper, that is a plausible evolutionary scenario that can happen if all of the details with the biology and the conditions and everything line up. Now, do those conditions line up in COVID? We don't know. We simply don't know. And there are other scenarios. So there are other directions that other sorts of variants that could be favored, including variants that do much less harm. And so we simply can't say from what we know at the moment whether the chicken case is directly analogous to the human case. And let's face it, very different virus, very different vaccine, and obviously people are not chickens. So right. Big differences. What I really took issue was that, in many ways, I was appreciative that Joe Rogan was pointing to the point, the importance of evolution in the ongoing pandemic, that the virus is expected to change. And we should be having a very serious discussion about that, what it might be like, and which directions it could go. What I could not deal with was the completely illogical step that therefore we should hold back life-saving vaccines. And all the people that are on the Twitter sphere now saying, this is a reason I'm not getting vaccinated, or we have to stop giving vaccines to people. You know, a scenario that played out in chickens that may or may not play out in humans is not a reason to stop life-saving drugs. And then on top of that, there are solutions that involve vaccines to what happened in the chicken case. So actually, what we were studying was the situation in the chickens that played out in the 1970s. In the 1980s, the vaccines were changed. The problem didn't go away immediately, but in the 1990s, the vaccines have changed some more and the problem went away. And the reason your chicken nuggets are cheap now is because they've optimized the vaccines to stop this problem. So the vaccines are a solution here. So if the evolution in this chicken case, if it played out the same way for SARS, a very different virus and very different hosts, very different vaccines, the solution would lie in the vaccines. It certainly doesn't lie in withholding vaccines.
Yeah, you're saying that the paper doesn't actually prove that vaccines are bad for the chickens to make a worse virus. What it showed ultimately is that the vaccines matured and solved the problem. But there's an interesting difference here, and I think it's everything. I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, or you can extrapolate and explain, the vaccine that was given to chickens didn't stop transmissibility at all, correct?
It reduced it, but it certainly didn't stop it. So all chickens with that vaccine were able to transmit the virus on.
Which is not the case with the COVID vaccines.
Somewhat still unclear, I'd say at the moment, the extent to which the COVID vaccine stopped transmission. We do know they greatly reduce it. We don't know to what extent they stop it. They certainly seem to shorten transmission periods. So they're really having an impact on transmission, no question.
So let's go down the gamut here. Well, actually, I want to tackle this because it's a question I have that I don't know. What accelerates mutations? Is it completely random? Or do viruses get together and say, hey, we got a new problem in this vaccine, and they think or intellectually come up with a way to beat it?
Mutations themselves happen completely at random. But the way to think about it is they happen at random every time the virus replicates. Okay, so when one virus turns into two, turns into four, each time that process happens, there's a chance of a mutation.
More replication, more mutation.
That's correct. So if you have, as we do in the moment around the world, you know, huge numbers of viruses replicating, vast numbers of viruses replicating, we're having vast numbers of mutations going on everywhere, right? And the bigger the number of, the more people that are infected, the more replications going on. The longer the infections last in a person, the more replication that goes on. The more viruses there are in a person, the more replication that goes on, and so forth. So the way to stop the mutations is to stop the virus replicating. You want to stop it as much as possible. So you stop transmission with face masks or distancing or whatever, working remotely. Get the virus numbers down in a body. Get the infection cleared faster. And that's what vaccines do. So those things reduce the amount of mutational input into the system.
Yeah, I think you explained it longhand, but then how are people getting your paper wrong as relating it to COVID?
Well, it's obviously hard for me to understand how other people's understanding works.
Well, I mean, you saw Rogan and what he said and how what he extrapolated from it. And I didn't read you what he said. I'm sure you can just react to that. He said, people are saying, oh, it's unvaccinated people that are responsible for the variants. Well, it's a quote. Well, it's actually, there are actually scientific papers, i.e. your paper, that point to the very sort of environment that we're creating by having so many people vaccinated with a vaccine that doesn't kill off the virus. It actually can lead to more potent viruses.
Yeah. So, Chris, I think this is a complicated issue, but let me just say, take something like Delta. Delta is a very, very transmissible virus. It's very infectious. It doesn't matter whether you are vaccinated or unvaccinated. It goes crazy, right? It's racing through the world. It's racing through America. It started in India where there were no vaccines and raced through. So it's a very, very effective virus at getting around. And from my perspective, arguing about whether the vaccinated or the unvaccinated are responsible for that is just crazy. What we care about is how far is Delta going to go, and is there going to be something next, a Delta plus plus or whatever? In those situations, we've got to try to stop the replication of the virus. And you do that with many measures, but one of the most important ones is vaccines.
So it's not that the vaccine it's not like people think of like antibiotics, like the bacteria adjust to the antibiotics and they overcome it. It doesn't work like that. It's not like the virus is studying the vaccine and saying, how do we defeat this? It's more, the more people spread it, the more opportunities it has to mutate. And by chance, one of those mutations could get around the vaccines.
That's correct, absolutely. And so from the point of view of where the evolution is happening, it matters where the virus is. Now, could the vaccinated people alter the direction of the evolution of the virus? There are absolutely ways it could do that. Vaccination could do that. But is that a bad thing? Well, it depends what happens, right? It could be that the viruses evolve to get better able to get around the vaccines. Could be they become nastier. Could be they become nicer. All of those, nothing could happen. All of those possibilities are out there. And I guess what I found irresponsible about the way that Rogan covered it was the implication that it's bound to make things worse, and the implication that the only solution is to stop the vaccination. Why would you hold back life-saving drugs for a hypothetical possibility that we could deal with? If we knew it was happening, we could deal with it by improving the vaccines.
Right. Well, I think the key here is to get people to understand, as I just learned, that it's not the hurdle of a vaccine that makes viruses mutate. It's simple transmission.
That's correct.
Stop the fire from spreading. Stop the mutations.
That's right. If you want to stop the evolution, stop the virus.
And it's not like the vaccines do stop transmission, not all the way. There are breakthrough cases and there are asymptomatic cases. But your body already has the army to try and fight a lot of this stuff when it gets in you if you have a vaccine. I mean, that's an important piece.
Yeah, that's completely correct, Chris. And the way I think about this is that it's really, really important that we think about the future, but we don't let the fear of the future get in the way of the big gains we've made. And for me, the vaccines that we have at the moment are miracles. It's incredible we got them so fast. Have we learned to use them the best way possible? Probably not yet. Maybe we need 3 shots. Maybe we need them further apart or closer together. Maybe we need higher doses each time. Lots of things we've still got to work out here. And if we can work those things out and get these vaccines to be even more potent than they are now, we'll have even more impact on the evolution by slowing it down or stopping it.
So one of the things people are saying is that Delta was created by the vaccines. Was Delta created by the vaccines?
Everything we know says that Delta came from India. And India before still has vaccines. Incredibly low vaccination rates.
But it came in December 2020 before vaccines were given out.
Exactly. So to me, Delta is a fantastic example of a very well-adapted virus that's able to spread very effectively in the unvaccinated and apparently can still spread in some vaccinated individuals some of the time. It's an amazing virus.
Could a variant still evolve in vaccinated people?
Yes, if the transmission is not stopped completely so that some people get infected with a virus, it replicates in their body and then transmits on. That's the potential for evolution, absolutely.
But the odds of it happening are fewer than
That's correct.
If everybody was unvaccinated.
That's correct. So if the vaccine is shortening the infections, reducing the number of viruses involved, decreasing the likelihood of a virus getting in there in the first place, all those things will restrict the ability of the thing to evolve. And the better we can do at that, shortening the infections, pushing them down, stopping them starting in the first place, the better we can do.
It's a simple metaphor. They used to cover wildfires in Arizona. And if you can, a fire always has the potential to spit up an ember to a new forest and start a new fire. But if you can do what you can on the big fire to really tamper that down, the odds of a new fire starting elsewhere lessen.
That's a great analogy, Chris. That's exactly the way I think about it. And vaccines aren't the only way to do that, right? You can socially distance, you can mask, you can work remotely. But from the point of view of keeping our life going in semi-normal ways, then the vaccines are by far the best way of doing that.
On a personal level, does it upset you that your research has become notorious?
Yeah, I'm actually quite terrified that people could die because of the way my work has been misinterpreted. I mean, I think that's a really, the reason we did the work was to figure out the circumstances into which these sort of things should happen and figure out ways to stop them happening. And instead, it's being at the moment warped to be an argument for putting people at risk and increasing the risk. I do find it deeply disturbing. I think the positive spin on our work and the reason it was funded by the National Institutes of Health is that we were trying to figure out under what circumstances could things happen that we might not like, and how would we stop that? And I think our paper is full of examples of how to do that, and the work we've done since is focused on that question. And to my mind, this is all for human benefit, and instead we find large numbers of people on the social media using it in a way that's going to harm. If people really do alter their vaccine behavior because of this, then people will be harmed.
There's another classic reason why misinformation is very dangerous, is because this may have been spread 100,000, half million, million and a half times, but a very, very small fraction of those people will either see or decide to look at a correction.
That's right. You know, and the other thing, Chris, I would say about this is what the sort of thing that makes people like me who work on vaccines and the effect on the virus nervous about this kind of work if it's going to get misinterpreted, right? So we end up thinking to ourselves, maybe we can only have these discussions in scientific fora, that we shouldn't be talking about these things in public because they might get misunderstood. And so we end up with a situation where behind closed doors, we talk about what's going on. We don't want to do that. We need to be up, open and up front. We need to discuss things sensibly so that we can have, where there's things to be concerned about, we can have sensible discussions about them.
Is there a way to put caveats in the research so that if a layman stumbles upon it, there's a big red warning like, yo.
Yeah. You mean like in the abstract, say, please read the discussion of the paper? Read the paper.
Or just like, yeah. I don't know.
The discussion. The discussion of the paper is full of caveats. And I had another paper which had a section called caveats, and it also had a risk consideration section. You know, we've got caveats everywhere. If you're just going to read the soundbite, you know, how do we, complicated stuff this, and we got to be thinking beyond the soundbite.
Yeah, I feel personally like we live in a very gray world full of nuance.
Yes.
But when you politicize anything, it becomes black and white, our team, your team, and it has to have a yes or no. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. And I think that's part of the problem we have in this case. That I do think our work shows there are things that humanity should be thinking about and be concerned about. But the conclusion is not, therefore, don't vaccinate. That's not the conclusion at all. And it's very clear if you read the paper, that's what it says. The history of the chicken industry is laid out clearly in the discussion that the solution to this all came through vaccines. And every chicken in the industry has been better off for being vaccinated than being not vaccinated. And not one chicken should have chosen to be not vaccinated. That would have been a disaster.
So let's be very clear. You wrote that paper.
Yes.
Joe Rogan misinterpreted that paper.
The conclusion that from that paper that we should not vaccinate is completely wrong.
Vaccines ended up saving the chickens ultimately.
Yeah, that's the reason your chicken nuggets are so cheap.
And vaccines are the way to tamper this current COVID fire.
It's the only way in the long way that's sustainable, Chris. None of the other measures we have at our hands are going to really damp this thing down.
And there are thousands of papers to back what you and I just said.
No question. Thousands of papers, including my own, Chris.
That's pretty clear to me, man.